cinquena jornada del programa Compartim. A continuació, tenim la intervenció d'una persona que ens ha semblat que era rellevant per al moment en què estem. Al febrer d'aquest any va venir Steve Dale, com sabeu, és l'ideòleg, el director d'aquella gran experiència que hi ha al Regne Unit, que són les comunitats de pràctiques que s'han establert a l'àmbit local. I aquí parlem de 22 comunitats, de 1.000 persones, allí parlem o allí estan parlant de més de 70.000 persones que estan vinculades en comunitat de pràctica, en una metodologia diferent, però sí que ha arrelat i es pot dir que sí que estan fent alguna contribució diferent. No sé si n'hi ha traducció per al CAR, perquè l'estic parlant de que ell parlarà després. CAR, i en aquella ocasió, com dic, Steve Dale parlava de si n'hi ha algun lloc on es pot visualitzar més quina ha estat l'aportació de les comunitats de pràctica, en general social media, el CAR parlava de social media, és precisament el comtat de Devon, no sé si ho pronuncio bé, Devon, és el comtat de Devon, i la persona que és darrere de tot aquest nivell d'interacció és precisament el CAR. CAR, aquí no en tenim traducció, podríem dir que és una mena de ell diu arquitecte organitzacional, aquí podríem dir expert en processos participatius, treballa directament per al contacte de Devon i és el que està darrere de tot aquest nivell d'interacció. Interacció per a què? Aquest és el repte que tenim davant. Tota aquesta interacció desplegada, aquesta nova organització, aquest nou disseny d'un lloc de treball per a fer aflorar la participació de les persones per millorar determinades àrees, aquest nivell ja té el seu nom professional, que és l'arquitecte de participació. A la qual cosa, CAR, que també és un apassionat dels mitjans digitals, té el seu propi blog molt visitat, és una persona que està darrere d'iniciatives ben importants allà a Anglaterra, avui tindrà el repte en situacions similars. Estem patint una crisi econòmica i hem enfocat precisament la seva intervenció si alguna cosa podria tenir aquesta interacció que estem intentant aflorar a través del social media, és que tingui algun valor econòmic. Tindrà algun valor econòmic? Podrà ser rendible en el futur? Vindrà tot aquest moviment a quedar-se? Aquests són dubtes que intentarem que CAR en la seva reflexió ens ajudi. Doncs molt bé, quan vulguis, CAR, tens tota la paraula.
Firstly, thank you for inviting me to Barcelona. It's my first visit. I apologise for bringing the bad weather with me. It's very cold in the UK at the moment. I hope you don't get the same levels of extreme weather that we've had. And I hope it warms up for you over the next when after I leave today, basically. It was interesting to hear that I was referred to as an expert. I hate that term. I think in the new social networked world, there's no such thing as an expert. We're all equal, we all co-create. And these are purely experiences and learnings that I've had along the way on trying to implement social networking, social collaboration tools. And the learning experiences that you have are likely to be unique to yourselves, but I'm hoping you'll get some aspects of learning that you'll be able to take with you from today.
So what I'm going to broadly cover is I'll give you a very short, I mean very short, introduction to the UK public sector context. Another short, brief introduction to the context for local councils in the UK, and then talk about the opportunities that social media and social collaboration tools can bring organisations, and then some challenges that I'm not convinced that we all know the answers to at the moment. Okay, so the UK's public expenditure in 2009, these are all sourced from our government, so I wouldn't worry too much about the actual figures. But we spend £609 billion in the UK public sector, and the UK local government expenditure is £164 billion. That is going to dramatically reduce over the next 3 to 4 years. The local authority I work for, Devon County Council, in 2009 had a budget of £865 million. That's going to probably reduce by 30% over the next 3 years. So we've got to consider some pretty radical changes to how we deliver public services on the front line, as well as supporting that from inside the organisation. It's quite a complicated, very much I can't imagine the situation of providing public services is that different around the world. We have a three-tier approach to local government in the UK. We have town and district, town and parish councils who provide the services on the right-hand side there. We have district councils who provide the services in the middle, tourism, environmental health, those kinds of services. And then the county council, the level that I work at, we're responsible for the more strategic services around adult education, safeguarding of children and adults, infrastructure, roads, transport, social services, those kinds of things. But the commonality that we all share is that we deliver services for people. That's essentially what we're all about. And when you talk about people, we have to understand the social interactions that they're all doing outside of our own processes. And it would be great to feel that our experiences and our processes were actually seen in a way that we appeared in people's processes, not the other way around. So the context for local councils in the UK, public sector finance, this isn't a new thing. It's going to get a lot worse. We're not quite sure exactly how bad yet. The local government settlement, the big figure that is divided between all the local authorities in the UK, will reduce by between 25 and 30%. But then each individual council has a formula grant, which could mean that some are affected more than others. That will inevitably mean the two biggest assets that we have, people, as well as our accommodation and property, will have to reduce. Those are our biggest costs, as well as pensions. But we're going to have to look at ways to reduce those kinds of costs across the public sector. There is increasingly more pressure from our citizens and the public in general to deliver more for less, and we would probably consider that we would like to deliver less for less. So there's a conflict between trying to maintain simple service levels whilst being faced with quite dramatic service budget reductions. And they also, and quite rightly, they want us to maintain social and digital inclusion and ensure that all of our participation activity is inclusive as we move forward. On the flip side, these kinds of devices, mobile phones and small laptops and tablet PCs and those kinds of things, are driving an increasingly more demand on our own organisations to deliver access to information at a far quicker rate. Very much most people nowadays expect information to be as close to real time as possible, and that's quite a challenge. I mean, there's a lot of talk at the moment about information being made available through WikiLeaks. these kinds of challenges that organisations will have in terms of the kind of social aspect of sharing and opening up government will have a huge, profound effect. There's also social networks give people the capacity, and you probably already know this, to self-organise. They can do all these kinds of things below our radar. They can cooperate, they can co-create, they can organise, they can protest, they can do whatever they feel they need to do in order to build a movement, to create a culture that's completely contrary to the kind of cultures that we have in our organisations. And that's a huge conflict when all of that is very much the people that we're essentially serving and delivering services to. So we need to make sure that our cultures aren't clashing in how we're dealing with the pressures of today's financial situation. So essentially, we are at a time when we need to consider extreme and transformational change. I don't believe, personally, that the current approach to delivering public services, at least in the UK, has any future whatsoever. I think it's quite clear that society itself is equipping itself with tools, free tools, to self-organise, to run events, to look after their friends and network with their neighbours, and deliver quite low-level public services around community care and self-organising ways that essentially enable them to look after their own communities. And we've got to understand now in the public sector in the UK where our position is, what our core proposition is. We need to rethink and reboot the whole of the UK public sector. Okay, so I'm going to go through a number of opportunities, and I think what's interesting about this is that most people I talk to in the UK, when I talk about social media and social networking, they all pretty much say the same thing, which is, I can see the value, but will it eat up all my time and make me less productive, or actually is this something that can actually deliver efficiency? And because there's still that question that exists in people's minds, it's still something that I feel people seem needs to be sold. It's something that people feel that they need to see the compelling argument to make it work. When people use their own personal devices, they're doing pretty much the same kind of things that organisations are doing. They're organising events for themselves, they're organising colleagues, they're collaborating with colleagues, and they'll use pretty consumer-grade technology that doesn't necessarily have the same levels of information security, for example, that we would expect in our own organisations. But that approach to how they organise their own lives, when they come into the organisations and they don't have that same level of collaboration or the same level of internal networking and co-creation, they tend to get quite frustrated. Well, I personally do, anyway. So in terms of uses, to be honest, I don't think there isn't a use that you couldn't think of for a type of social media. After all, the social media splits into three kind of domains. There's the technology domain, which has traditionally been referred to as Web 2.0, and that's the kind of technology infrastructure behind social media. There's the social and community aspects, which is kind of some of the aspects around communities of practice, where people engage and the kind of benefits around that. And then there's the inside your own organisations, the kind of internal approaches to these. So you've got, you can buy large industry grade or kind of commercial products that do social software, social collaboration functions. Products, I wouldn't necessarily say SharePoint as a product would do that, but it would be considered in the same context as delivering collaboration. There are other social tools that do that. But interestingly, in the UK, there was a survey by the Society of IT Management of public sector IT managers in 2009, and they were asked what they thought the potential uses for social media were in the UK. And interestingly, there were a whole range of things, and we'll touch on some of these areas in a moment. But the most interesting thing is that not one IT manager in the UK said that there was no use at all. And yet there is still a huge issue in organisations about questioning where the value is. So, the next few slides are going to essentially give you some broad experiences across the from within my own authority, but also across colleagues in the UK public sector who have been doing some quite innovative things using social software to do a number of areas. So, I'll focus on improving communication. Communication as a function in an organisation seems quite a peripheral activity. It can empower people, although we've seen with the kind of WikiLeaks the kind of the extreme activity of giving people information that might not necessarily be in their best interests, perhaps. But improving and empowering people to engage through the use of social tools, either through formal networks that you build yourself through tools that you buy and you build a social network on the back of your website, or you can find communities. There are communities already in existence in social sites like Facebook, for example. I suspect there's already a number of Facebook groups in for this particular region or your particular organisation or services that your organisation do. And it's an opportunity for us to listen to those conversations and engage in their conversations and take our conversation to them as opposed to expecting them to come to us. And I think the whole impact of social software is about reversing the power shift in the communication. It's very much about us relinquishing control to the citizen to actually decide when they actually receive information from us. As I mentioned earlier, there's a huge opportunity and there's a huge drive around mobile and real-time communication. And as staff in organisations, as employees in organisations, there's a real opportunity to consider using social networks or location-based social networks such as Foursquare or Gowalla are two consumer-grade examples where you can check into a location and essentially you could consider building some very simple workflow on the back of that, so someone could check into a location and then be delivered or be prompted with a series of tasks. So we've been trying to work out whether we can how this might actually work in practice for educational support workers or highways engineers. So when they check into a particular location or a town, there might be a series of tasks to fill holes in the road or to fix streetlights, those kinds of things. So actually associating tasks with a particular geographical location and enabling them to be displayed through the mobile network. There are huge opportunities around internal use of social media or social software or social computing, depending on which term that you're familiar with. And there are huge opportunities externally, but what I would advise is that don't try and engage with people externally online unless you've got a competency or a skill and an understanding of what engaging with people online means in terms of your own organisational culture. There's some interesting learning we did in Devon where we piloted a social network inside the organisation to look at how the culture of our organisation would be affected. It was a small pilot, but some of the key aspects to that were if we didn't embed the social processes in our actual processes themselves, then we didn't get any value. So, for example, we had a social network where we had a separate process of communicating with each other through our email group distribution lists. You've probably got those, you probably use them as well. That's probably quite a familiar way of contacting with your colleagues across organisations. A group distribution list in email, then a discussion emerges, the email trips out into various different discussions, and then if you're lucky to be copied in through all of those discussions, you'll be able to see the context of the conversation. What we did in the social collaboration environment was that all conversation and all email activity in the team was banned. So we completely banned email within the team, and we would do all our internal discussion, email activity in the social platform. So it enabled people to see the actual hierarchy of an organisation, see the thread, see the discussion, see the trail of the discussion, see where it kind of diverted. And it also means that you don't have to worry about managing your inbox in the same way. Now, it took my inbox was around about 500 emails a week, and in that process of eliminating internal email from within the team, it reduced to about 80 in a week. So there was significant personal gain from banning my email activity or moving my email activity into a platform where I could simply just dip in and out of the conversation. Didn't feel because the email was in my inbox, I needed to treat it as a task. And I think some people are almost slaves to their inbox. So if an email comes in, you almost feel obliged to answer it, acknowledge it, and maybe forward that. And I think that's a culture that we need to deal with. And I think if we pushed some of that activity away into a more social collaboration environment, you'd actually feel, I personally felt liberated, that I didn't have to manage my inbox in such a kind of hard way. And I'll come on to some more examples about internal use later through the presentation. There are some huge opportunities, but also some quite big challenges around managing the reputation of an organisation. Because if you're not already listening, there may be reputation damage going on around your organisation now. So for example, we started listening into a website called Twitter. Just a quick show of hands. Who's heard of Twitter? Okay, so good. Thank God. Good, so we started listening in Twitter for our organisational name, and within a matter of days, we'd seen some quite interesting conversation emerging. And that wasn't necessarily polite, and I assumed that the people who were making those comments probably didn't expect us to be listening in that way. So once we started to just politely engage and acknowledge what they were saying, we actually found that their approach to us became more productive. So they weren't just throwing stones from afar. They actually started to engage in a conversation with us. So we actually were able to maybe mitigate quite the possibility of a reputation disaster emerging out of quite a simple set of Twitter conversations. And because we were just quite simply saying, yeah, we hear what you say, maybe we could deal with that in this way or direct them to a formal process, it enabled us to kind of just manage that expectation in a way that probably they didn't expect. Enhancing democracy. Now, I'm still not entirely convinced that we really do enhance democracy, but there are lots of ways in which the citizens feel that they are getting a greater say in society. Now, whether that's actually democracy is for maybe a different debate, but there are huge numbers of groups out there who are collaboratively coming together to build new tools using social tools for free. WikiLeaks is an example where, or any kind of site, where people are just coming together for a purpose that they feel represents the opening up of government. They feel it increases transparency and accountability. And they're using all of these tools to collaboratively come together and to do action. Now, that on the face value is a really positive thing. However, if it's done from outside and it's seen as something that isn't kind of brought in or as an organisation you don't acknowledge the potential value of those kinds of initiatives, then you will get the kind of examples where WikiLeaks is hitting the news and saying we want to take criminal action against this organisation because it's putting people at risk. I think if they'd engaged earlier with that kind of conversation, they may have been able to understand the underlying purpose of what that WikiLeaks program was all about, and at least try and manage the expectation within that community about what types of information were coming out of, and how they might go about managing that process collaboratively and together. And that comes on to the next point about sites like Facebook are very easy to create an illusion that there's a petition emerging. And one thing we need to recognise is that these online spaces are only an amplification of, can be an amplification of extreme views offline. And just because someone is active in an online environment doesn't mean that they're active in a community. So we can't make those assumptions, but some people are. So if somebody just simply innocently creates a petition to say, stop Heathrow Terminal 5, for example, being created, there are ways in which you can formalise those processes and engage with those campaigns. Now, you can either create your own campaign separately and alienate those communities who are coming together for a common purpose, or you can engage in an adult conversation and understand some of the underlying issues that they have, very much if you were entering a community village hall or a community space in person and having that same conversation with them in that space about those issues. So in terms of approaching campaigning and collaborative action, it's very much mirroring your existing processes about how you might go into a small community, consult with them on a particular planning process. This just gives you an opportunity to amplify those conversations to a wider audience and actually allow people to engage in those conversations at times that are convenient to them. So for example, the reaching disengaged audiences, we did a pilot project in Devon where we used Facebook, a private Facebook group, to engage with young teenage pregnant mothers. And one of the advantages of using that as a tool was they were already in Facebook, they were quite active in Facebook, so it felt quite an obvious choice. We consulted with them beforehand to see whether, as an organisation, us involving them in that space was appropriate, and they agreed, so we were quite fortunate. And then we set some parameters to how our engagement would be managed, and we made sure that it was a private group, it was an invite only, and it was about support and networking and how we would provide and signpost access to help. One of the interesting things we found about this is that there was a higher engagement level and higher participation level with those parents who engaged through the social network, because they felt they were in there, when they were engaging, they were obviously at home or in an environment they felt secure and safe, so they could engage at a time that was convenient to them. It may have been 3 o'clock in the morning, just after a baby feed, or it could have been in the afternoon when the baby was asleep. However, it wasn't, and the key point for us to recognise, it wasn't about us inviting them into our offices between 11 and 12 on a Tuesday and saying, you need to come and talk to us to find out what kind of support you can access. It was very much about building that conversational style of approach to participation that allowed them to dip in and out. And us, one of the early lessons we learned within the first couple of weeks was we need to manage the expectations of when a particular youth support worker was going to be available. There was an assumed expectation that it was 24 hour. Now, we're not quite to that level of staffing at the moment, and I doubt we'll ever move to those kinds of things. And in the context of public sector cuts, actually managing our expectations about when we're going to be available in these spaces, we need to be clear that citizens know we're going to be here at this time, but please continue the conversation while we're not here. So there were some really interesting learnings there, and part of that process actually enabled us to develop quite a robust internal social media policy that allows everybody in my organisation I currently work for to access social media during work time for either social or business purposes. Building communities. Now, actually, when I put this together, I wasn't quite sure I really mean building communities, because communities build themselves, and we don't necessarily need to build them for them. I think if we feel that we can go into a space like Facebook and build a community, then we'll pretty much be left in isolation in that space, and we'll pretty much start to build quite a negative reputation about some of these tools, because it will fundamentally fail. So I think the key aspect here about communities is about connecting with communities, and either if you don't already do simple thing, well, it's not, I mean, it's not a simple thing, but if you don't do a simple task such as doing a social media audit on your existing online communities, quite a quick first task for an organisation who wants to engage in social media would be to conduct quite a simplistic, brief audit of the levels of communities that exist online, whether that's in Facebook or whether it's in community discussion forums. But having a clear view as to what communities exist will enable you to manage your priorities to say, well, these communities are pretty much self-managed, there's nothing controversial or no issues emerging from these. So perhaps we target these other two who are talking about safeguarding of adults, or they're talking about children's care. So maybe we need to send some of our people into those discussions and get some of our colleagues from public health or whoever it may be to actually join in those discussions, as opposed to going there and saying, come and join our discussion somewhere else in an environment that we've created. But also, just the fact that these communities can come together in these spaces, we've already started to see at quite a low level, just some neighbourhoods reconnecting. So people didn't realise that people they were connecting with online actually lived down the road. So in the UK, I can't imagine it's like this in Spain, to be honest, but in the UK, the concept of local community is kind of disappearing. People are very much engaged in kind of different communities of, there are communities of practice, communities of purpose, communities of geography, or communities of travel to work areas. So people don't tend to be that active in their physical communities at home anymore. And what we're seeing at quite a low level is people are realizing that somebody they've engaged with quite often in a Twitter conversation or in a Facebook world or in a community of practice actually might live down the road, so they can come together and talk about community action at a real local level. So that's about bringing people to people. And one of the things that we always try and make sure that we promote when we do this in the UK is that this isn't a substitute for face-to-face or offline activity. It can complement your existing offline activity, but I wouldn't expect any organisation to stop consulting with people on a face-to-face basis, just on the basis of a Facebook group or a social network. But what I do believe is that using those as ways to increase the conversation, to continue the dialogue, so it's not just a single consultation activity, you're actually building a relationship with a community about their needs, about their local priorities, and having that through a conversational style and facilitated through potentially free consumer-grade tools is quite powerful. One of the things that our coalition government in the UK are promoting quite heavily at the moment is this concept of big society, where they're hoping, my personal view, they're hoping that as public sector jobs are cut, that communities themselves will fill the gap that our services are no longer providing, and communities will come together and become active and stronger and start delivering public services so we don't have to, as a way of cutting our costs. Now, things like this always happen. Things like this have happened for a long time. People are organising rugby groups and football teams, netball teams, sports groups. All these kinds of things are essentially low-level kinds of active participation and involvement in society. And often these people are doing it because they believe and they're passionate about those things. And it's the same thing where in some areas local libraries are maintained on the basis of voluntary contribution. And the concept that the big society wants to foster is that very much that approach on a much larger scale, where potentially people would want to take ownership of their local school, or they want to deliver social care. There's a lot of issues about how we actually manage that. But that's the kind of ambition where our society becomes a lot more active, and therefore our involvement can focus on the kind of core values around safeguarding and provision of those kinds of things. And one of the things I'm keen on not doing through this whole presentation is focusing on how we would use those technologies, but very much the kind of conceptual level of what they're there to do, because these tools will evolve. Facebook may not be there in 5 to 10 years, but actually the philosophy that you approach to building relationships with citizens must be the thing that you build in as a sustainable process. And if you're doing that in a way that delivers community value, then whatever social tool you're using will continue in a way that delivers value. Other aspects that you can use, I think if I could probably talk all day, but I won't, around the value of social media and social networking. There's a whole range of things inside organisations, I think, are really powerful places to start. Because I believe, as an organisation, if we don't understand what this means for us as an organisation, then we'll never understand how it means to citizens to engage with us in the same kind of way. So it is very much about sharing knowledge, not managing. Managing knowledge is very much a separate activity. It's very much about documenting, classifying kind of aspects of knowledge. Sharing knowledge is an activity that we do right now, for example, and I suspect you'll do knowledge sharing over coffee. You probably do it in cafes, in pubs, at the water coolers. All these kinds of things are knowledge sharing activities. And social media just provides an amplification of those kinds of scenarios, and doesn't only, and is actually more inclusive, because if you're not at that coffee machine at a particular time to hear a conversation, you've missed out on that knowledge sharing activity. However, if we're capturing these tools in knowledge sharing tools or social tools, we've got huge opportunities for other people who may not have been there to build value into that conversation, to extend that conversation and develop ideas, and to develop new ways and innovative ways of thinking about service delivery. There's a whole range of e-learning and professional development opportunities, and also personal development opportunities within these spaces. There's a lot of informal learning and formal learning. I've learned a huge amount from just watching various videos in YouTube. Not those kinds of videos, but ones where you would see kind of TED Talk videos. And a huge range of formal learning through posting particular things on my blog and getting comments and chatting quite constructive challenges from people. I think there's some talk later about communities of practice. One of the things that we've got in the UK, and we're quite fortunate to have, is our Local Government Improvement and Development Agency have provided a platform which is free to all public services in the UK called Our Communities of Practice. And it's pretty much a space for us to grow knowledge, share experiences, do all the things that you can do in a social platform, but this is kind of more of an organisational base. And in Devon at the moment, we're looking at how this might be able to replace our intranet and extranet capability moving forward, so we can start reducing costs. One thing I think is really key is I'm going to pick out just briefly here where the actual productivity savings can be made and where the financial savings can be made. In terms of, I don't know about you personally, but I spend a lot of time looking for information. And in the kind of social platform sense, the fact that other people have classified information for me, people I know, they've classified that information, it makes it a hell of a lot easier to find, a lot quicker to find, therefore there's a productivity gain in accessing and finding information. In Devon, the social software tool that we used actually enabled us to stop meeting in person for a series of meetings. So that means we actually saved money on venue costs, people costs, and associated resources. So there was a physical cost saving to that. Less email. I mentioned that earlier. That was a personal highlight of mine. And e-learning. Again, we've delivered webinar capabilities and video capabilities, which enabled us to save on venue costs and people costs and training costs. So briefly, the challenges, and I'm going to go through these briefly because I think they're quite broad, and I think you might have some additional challenges for yourselves. The question I get asked is, if all these tools are really useful and everyone's using them, Why aren't we all using them inside the organisation? Well, there's some risk issues. The social web is still considered immature, but I actually think that's a strength. We do have issues around digital inclusion, making sure that people are still included. We've got a huge issue in the UK about connectivity in rural areas. Organisations still do block access to sites like Facebook. And information security. Information security people in the UK love saying that these sites are huge risks. I don't believe they are. I think people are risks, and if they don't understand information security, there's your vulnerability. I don't think this will ever go away. It's about who you are. Are you there in these sites on a personal, in a personal capacity or a professional capacity? That's something I think individually you need to think about yourself. But we can learn in terms of organisationally how we approach these things from things like how we adopted email. We adopted email, we have personal email accounts and we have professional email accounts. They converged and we kind of have personal, professional kind of email accounts now. There's a massive challenge to organisations in terms of the culture that exists. If we're fundamentally challenging the hierarchy of an organisation by flattening the conversation structure so that a senior manager or the chief executive officer can talk to anybody at any level, then we are fundamentally challenging managers in organisations in terms of their role. There's huge culture change. We won't deliver any value unless we change the way we work and deliver different processes to support these new ways of working. And this is pervasive. If we don't change the way our organisations work, we may have difficulty in the recruitment and retention of staff. Finally, on political challenges, I'm not sure we'll get to these kinds of answers in a forum like this. I think this is a forum for politicians to get to grips with. Do they engage? How they engage? What challenges? What purpose they have? If people are now able to have a direct route to a service manager to say, this is how I want the service delivered, how does that get balanced with an elected official who essentially has the same responsibility? I think this is a whole thing about coming down to balancing and accountability, those kinds of purposes. So some final thoughts. There are real opportunities for financial and non-financial cost savings, but you will only receive those savings if you change your processes. Improvements can be made and you will see a huge amount of value if you embed these tools in your processes. We cannot see these tools as something that sits over there. We have to see them as part of our day-to-day activity. So accessing my email should be the same as accessing my Facebook and those kinds of things. And just as a word of caution, don't let anybody tell you that they're a social media expert and come into your business to tell you how you should deliver social media. You know your business best, and you'll know which processes you can deliver, you can change. So on that note, I'll say thank you.
Preguntas. Per poder fer al nostre invitat. Si teniu alguna pregunta, sisplau. Obriré el foc jo, aprofitant que estic aquí al costat. Car, es pot dir que podria haver alguna relació directa entre el nou govern al Regne Unit, el Cameron, en anuncis de retallades de serveis que s'ofereixen habitualment, funció pública, anuncia acomiadament de funcionaris, programes socials també que àmpliament sostingut en el temps al Regne Unit baixaran. Podria tenir alguna relació en increment d'aquesta xarxa social més activa, més productiva, per tal d'oferir nous serveis? Heu notat una acceleració? O en principi és un tempus que no està tan en relació a la conjuntura, a l'increment del social media?
Okay, I think there is a link.
However, I'm not sure it was directly linked to the new coalition government. I think society in the UK has been growing and wanting to collaborate through these spaces a lot more over the past 3 to 4 years. However, I think the focus of these groups is now becoming more about service delivery, because the government is saying, if we don't fund this particular service, then who's going to step in and fill that gap? Now, I think there's a big assumption about whether the capability and the capacity exists in these community groups to take on kind of that formal level of service delivery. And I think in terms of, I think the groups exist, but I think as organisations, we need to actually work with them to understand what capabilities they need, what capacity they need, and actually the reality of taking on those kinds of services. It isn't something that you can just say, yes, we'll suddenly take over a school because we're really passionate about it. I think there are some fundamental issues that you need to understand about managing a school. There are huge financial pressures around schools. There's obviously a curriculum to deliver. There's assets that people may not be familiar with managing. There's quite significant budgets. If people are just engaged in small, low-level activities in community groups, stepping up to that kind of more formal activity may be a bit of a step too far for some people. But we are looking at how we can... I think one of the things we're trying to adopt approach of understanding what kind of business capability it needs to exist in these services, so that we can work with community groups to build those capabilities and understand the capacity that they need. But we're still kind of dubious as to whether groups will actually come forward.
Dintre de l'exposició del senyor Clark, ens ha parlat, o m'ha sobtat, la idea d'una xarxa social en la que es debat les crítiques, és a dir, les opinions negatives o els comentaris que no són ben rebuts per la pròpia organització. Aquesta xarxa social que entra a debatre i que, per l'exposició de ponent, ha arribat a un bon resultat, com es gestiona? És a dir, és a nivell tècnic. El polític també arriba a participar dintre d'aquest debat social. Com es gestiona aquesta acció de la, diguéssim, clarificadora o d'empatia dintre de la red social?
I think we're still learning how to cope with those kinds of groups, to be honest. I think when groups are negative about our organisation, in an online sense, we struggle to know how to respond in a way that's constructive and mitigates any escalation of the discussion. Our political representatives are just about learning how to use the tools, so they're not formally engaged in the conversation yet. Although if the situation escalates, we would seek advice on how to respond, and someone else would essentially respond on their behalf. But what we're trying to build into people's thinking is that if we were in a public space, in that community group themselves, and they were saying the same kind of things, how would we respond in person is the same process we want to adopt as how we would respond online. However, if it's a formal complaint, we would still encourage people to use our formal complaints procedures. We don't want to see that just because these spaces exist, they can bypass some of our formal processes around complaint and feedback. However, if it's just formally conversation with someone saying, we don't like what Council A is doing, or we don't like this particular organisation for these reasons, then we simply just try and understand
what the kind of root cause is. But that would generally be managed through our public relations and communications professionals at this point in time. So there's still a huge amount of learning for our elected representatives.
Good morning, Mr. Hardy. Welcome to Barcelona, and thank you for your wonderful exposition this morning. One of the things I think maybe we can find in our job at the public administration is the fear that people who is on the top of the administration have about social media and social working, everything that relates to be open on internet, on computers, and whatever things they go with this. Is there any recommendations you can give us to deblock our directive people and say, hey, we need to do this and we need to go further on this? Thank you.
Okay, that's a great question. And it's a very familiar question. I think I've got two answers. One is a recommendation, one is an observation. The observation first, I think the kind of response you get from senior management is based on a fear because they simply don't understand the technology and they don't understand the impact of the technology. Because where I've met senior managers who do have social media presence of some kind, so they're in Facebook or they're in LinkedIn or those kinds of sites, they're far more supportive and they understand the kind of benefits. So it is about awareness. So what I would say as a recommendation is basically there's kind of two parts of the recommendation is be persistent and raise awareness of what these tools do. Cite good examples of where these things have already happened. You could search Google, you can just put a search in Google for social media examples, public sector, and there'll be a whole range from all over the world. So there's a point about raising the awareness, and then the other aspect is actually to try and focus on a particular issue that senior manager has currently, and to look at how you might solve that using social tools in some way. So for example, if they have particular issues about getting customer feedback on a particular service or customer input onto a consultation, there's an example that I'll just share with you. An example, we had a conversation with our people who deal with planning, and they were looking at a consultation for a planning proposal. And they just wanted to have something, so they took a display, and they took it to a hall, and they complained that nobody really turned up. So we kind of revisited that and looked at how we might add value to that. So we just kind of modelled up a scenario to say, if you, before the event, did some video on YouTube or just interviewed maybe somebody who was trying to kind of explain what the planning proposal was about, you could then post that into a YouTube environment, signpost that to particular community groups, and start some conversation. You could also use in Twitter, you could say, this consultation, we're going to we'll encourage feedback using a particular Twitter hashtag. So you could have hashtag consultation or whatever you might want to use. And then also, when you actually have that physical event, if you use either a small mobile phone or a very small handheld video, you could actually interview some of the people who are turning up and get live feedback to what they think, and then share that back out with other people. So the people who can't turn up at that designated time, because I think that's one of the problems we don't recognise, is that we're all busy, we can't always turn up at a particular venue at a particular time, and those people who do are the same people who always turn up at those venues, and that they're the same views that always get represented. So this is purely about looking at kind of a very simple scenario and saying, with this approach, you would actually reach this much more people, or this many more people, and therefore the value to the consultation would be increased. It's about linking the outputs to what to the kind of social media usage to actual real business outputs and business outcomes, as opposed to just saying Facebook's pretty cool, we should be using it, but at the same time kind of raising their awareness of broadly what these tools can do, and with our elected members, coming back to our elected members, actually running some training sessions on what is Twitter, how have people used it, what is Facebook, how are people using that, and citing good examples of where some elected members have built quite a strong following in Twitter, and some elected members have built quite a strong following in Facebook. You can find those one or two examples, and really it's about that person seeing personal value. So it's an evolutionary step, but the key thing about senior managers is there's a fear about misunderstanding, and there's also a fear about relinquishing control, because a lot of this is about pushing control out into the organisation and out to citizens. And my experience of some senior managers is that they like that control, and when they relinquish that, they feel personally threatened.
Entes, una pregunta més, no sé si s'ha arribat alguna via Twitter, que estem transmetent l'acto via streaming també. Doncs... Molta... Sí, la última pregunta, última, i ja passem a la taula rodona.
Hola, bon dia. Li volia preguntar, a veure, estem en una època en què el voluntariat cada vegada té més importància i hi ha gent que col·labora perquè té temps lliure, doncs en activitats socials. Volia preguntar-li si aquesta, si s'ha produït una integració al Regne Unit, doncs aquest voluntariat dintre d'aquestes xarxes socials col·laborant amb l'Estat, perquè és un potencial humà molt, molt important que es pot aprofitar i que amb aquesta manca de recursos doncs pot ajudar, diguem, també a pal·liar aquesta manca de recursos. Gràcies.
The quick answer is yes. As I mentioned earlier, the UK coalition government are promoting this big society concept, and that is focusing our attention on existing groups, voluntary groups or community organisations of some form, who are delivering services in particular areas. So we've already started to engage in some areas. So we have a strong, in my particular area, there are a lot of voluntary organisations who already provide social care for the elderly. So we've started to engage with them about how they can complement and add value to our services, and how they might fit into the whole kind of service delivery model. But I still think there's a big exercise that we need to do about mapping those organisations and understanding the actual current capabilities that they have in order to understand what scope they could have in a future public service delivery model. So one of the things that we're trying to promote in the UK is this concept of social enterprise, where organisations have social values, and we're trying to encourage some small medium businesses to convert to a social enterprise model, where essentially they would have a social outcome of supporting vulnerable children. So they would have a business model where they would generate income, but 50% of their business, their profit, would have to be put towards social outcomes. And I think it's about recognising that maybe some of the voluntary organisations, we need to encourage them to be more professional, take a more business approach to the delivery, and see the kind, I think there's levels and layers of voluntary contribution. Some aspects of voluntary contribution are verging on professional organisations now, and some aspects of voluntary contribution are literally the kind of football club, rugby club kind of scenario. And I think we're trying to support them through new approaches to business advice and social enterprise models and those kinds of things. But I think it's about us understanding where those capabilities and capacity lies. But that would be on an individual service basis, to see whether we could essentially commission those organisations to deliver those services on our behalf.
Moltes gràcies, no tenim més temps. Agrair la presència de la que feu, que interessant a veure el futur i moltes gràcies.